introduzione.
Come vuoi.
Late enough that we can start. So
he wants to finish on time. So let's welcome Rosanna Drovetti.
Good morning, everyone. I'm glad to have you here. I'm a PhD student at IFAM in Milan, which is a research institute that is entirely focused on cancer research. And as physicists, what we want to do is to develop a model that can explain quantitatively the cell behavior. And in my case in particular, I focus on growth control. So before getting to the model, I want to introduce a few concepts that I know you are already familiar with it, but I will introduce it anyway. We have that when a cell is exponentially growing, steady-state exponential, we have that the state of its proteon composition is tightly related to the growth rate. And for proteon, we refer to the whole group of proteins that are expressed by a cell in a certain condition, and they usually group them into a group of proteins that are that are expressed in a coordinated way. And this usually it's the same classification that you will get by dividing them into functional properties. The composition of the protein is given by the relative amount of the sectors. So as you can see from the plot on the right, when a cell is growing at different growth rate, it will express, in this case, the proteome sector it will get a different size of the proteome sector because the ribosome will be more or less expressed. And also the other sector will change accordingly. And this is what is generally called the fast growth loop. So those relations arise because of the problem of resource allocation. Because a cell, in order to grow, needs to allocate some resources toward the ribosome, because they are the one that synthesize new protein and allow the cell to build up the biomass. But in order to do that, the cell needs amino acid and other precursors in order to make the protein. So in order to grow, the cell does not only need the ribosome, but also to allocate some resources towards the metabolic proteins that take care of the consumption of the nutrient and they make the amino acid. The growth law arises because of this trade-off between metabolism and protein synthesis. What is missing from this theory is the description. What is still missing is the description of the regulatory circuit that actually implement this regulatory strategy. For example, in bacteria, it's known that the PPGPP is the circuit that regulates a lot of important processes inside the cell, and among these, there's the growth rate control, because PPGPP is the one that basically sets how many ribosomes the cell is going to produce. And our aim here is to integrate this knowledge on the PPGPP circuit with the theory of growth law and proteome sector. And to come up with a quantitative model that integrates both of these two theories. So I'm going to introduce now our framework, which is composed of four main parts. So the first ingredient are the regulatory function of the proteome sector, which is basically the function that tells how the total biomass flux is divided into the three sectors that we are considering here. That are the ribosomal, the constitutive, and the housekeeping sector. So basically, those functions, in other words, they tell which is the fraction of ribosomes that are producing other ribosomes that are producing constitutive protein and housekeeping protein. To understand how the sector dynamics is related to the value of those functions, one needs to take into account the definition of the sector, which is basically the mass of the protein that belong to that sector divided by the total protein mass, and also the equation for the accumulation of biomass. In particular, from the equation, you can see that the accumulation of the total biomass is simply the total biosynthesis flux, while if we want the accumulation of a mass of a specific sector, is the total bioflux multiplied by chi, which is the regulatory function for that sector specifically. So it's a fraction of the total synthesis flux. And putting together these two equations with the definition of the sector, we see that the dynamic for the sector size is related to the value of the regulatory function in that way. And from this equation, we also see that to achieve the steady state, we need that the size of the sector is equal to the value of the regulatory function. Okay, the next ingredient is to understand how the value of the ribosome of the regulatory function arises, because we want to know how the ribosome can know how many ribosomes they have to produce, how many housekeeping protein and constitutive protein. The fact is that the ribosomes do not know those particular ratio that they have to produce the protein. They just randomly attach to the mRNA and start transcribing for whatever is coding them. Therefore, we think that, we propose that the regulatory function, their value arises it's strictly tied to the composition of the mRNA pool. And we define the regulatory function as the fraction for the sector I, as the fraction of the transcript for that gene I divided by the total transcript. So in order to understand the dynamics of the regulatory function, we need to look into the transcript dynamics, which is given by a production term, beta P, where P is the RNA polymerases, and a degradation term. This for the total transcript, while if we look at the transcript for a particular sector, in this case the it's written for the ribosomal one, we have that the production term is multiplied by a function, omega, which is really similar to the regulatory function for the proteome synthesis. Here, omega is telling us how many RNA polymerases are transcribing for ribosomal gene in this case. So putting together the two equations for the transcript dynamic and the definition of chi that was in the other slide, we found this equation for the dynamic of the regulatory function. And also from here, we can see from this equation and the one before, we see that a steady state a requirement is that omega equal chi equal pi for any given sector. So in bacteria, we know that the PPGPP is the one that set how many ribosomal transcripts I'm going to produce, because it interferes with the binding of the RNAP on the ribosomal promoter. Therefore, omega r will be a function of the PPGPP level, and we set this function by the fitting of steady state data. Okay, the next ingredient is to understand how the level of PPGPP is fixed. And in this case, we choose to adhere to the last paper by Terry Wass' lab, where they basically found an empirical relation between the PPGPP level and the elongation rate, the translation elongation rate. In general, the PPGPP will be the PPGPP level will be determined by a term of that represents the synthesis of the PPGPP and a term that represents the degradation. And Wu and co-authors in their paper they propose that the synthesis term is proportional to the dwelling time, which is the time that the ribosome after the elongation is the time that the ribosome waits to get another charge tRNA, while the degradation and this time is of course also related to the abundance of tRNA, of amino acid and other elongation factor. While the degradation of PPGPP, they propose that is instead proportional to the time of translocation, so to the time that it takes for an amino acid to get incorporated into the protein and for the ribosome to move to the next codon. Putting together this equation with the definition of the translation rate, where the inverse of the translation rate is given by the sum of these two times, we get to the empirical relation between the PPGPP level and the elongation rate. Epsilon tilde is the maximum elongation rate. So basically, when the elongation rate is maximum, we get that the PPGPP level is zero, while when my ribosome is lower, I build up the PPGPP. Okay, so the last ingredient that we need is to understand what is the dynamic for the amino acid. And here is relatively simple, because the dynamics is just given by the influx of amino acid mediated by the constitutive sector, where nu is the nutrient quality of the external nutrients, and the outflux, which is given by the biomass flux, because are the ribosomes that are using the amino acid in order to build the protein. While the minus lambda psi is a dilution term given by the growth of the cell. Okay, so I finished presenting my model. I do a quick recap here. So basically we have that the size of the sector is decided by the regulatory function. The regulatory function are tied to the composition of the mRNA pool, which is given by the PPGPP mediated ribosomal, transcript dynamics. The PPGPP level is determined by the speed of the ribosome elongating, and at the end, the amino acid level is just set by the equilibrium of the different fluxes. So now I'll show you the theoretical result that we get with this model. So firstly, we wanted to make sure that our model predicted for a stable fixed point, because otherwise any kind of perturbation would just drove the system off its trail. And we found that the fixed point of the model are stable, and they also reproduce the first growth law, which this is an important prediction because, as you have seen before, we did not use the first growth law as a definition for our model. So this is indeed a genuine prediction of the model. And another thing we can predict is the growth law for the size of the amino acid pool. And we can do that because in our model, we explicitly describe this quantity. And the prediction is that also for the size of the amino acid pool, we get a linear relation, which is increasing in the growth rate. Okay, then we wanted to understand the nature of the relaxation toward the new steady state after a perturbation in the nutrients. And what we find is that the relaxation is characterized by damped oscillation. And in particular, you can see that, in particular, we have seen that all the relative, all the important quantities in the model are showing this dynamic. Even the size of the even the size of the sector, which are the quantities that change with the slower time scale. Because in order to change them, the cell need to make new biomass and to dilute the inert composition. Okay, then we wanted to study why this particular behavior arises. And what we found is that this behavior can arise under a very wide set of conditions. And it's not mandatory that the regulatory circuit the equation that we showed before. The really important things is that between the ribosome and the amino acid pool, it's important that there is this incoherent feedback between them. So we have that the ribosome presence inhibit the presence of amino acid because the ribosome use the amino acid in order to make proteins. So the more ribosome I have, the less amino acid I will have. And on the other, for the other interaction, we have that the presence of amino acid enhance the presence of ribosome because if the cells if the cell sense that I have more amino acid than required, it means that the constitutive sector is a bit too big for that experiment for that external environmental condition. Therefore, it will enhance the production of protein in order to go back to the desired proteome composition. And yes, as long as this feedback between these two quantities is maintained, we get the stable fixed point and the oscillatory. Yes.
So what is the mechanistic? I mean, I understand the mechanistic arrow at the top is trivial, right?
Yes.
They take amino acids and
string them together.
Yes.
But what is the mechanistic arrow at the bottom?
Okay, basically, we have that when the amino acid build up, the elongation speed of the ribosome, I mean, the ribosome will start to go faster because they have more substrate to use to make the protein. If the elongation goes up, the PPG...
That depends on tRNA pools, no? Not directly on amino acids.
Yes, it also depends on the tRNA pools. In our model, that's right, but the first signal that the environment is changing is not on the tRNA pools. That I mean, tRNAs are still something that you need to synthesize, so it cannot be the first signal of the environment changing. But the first thing that the cell sense is that there are more carbon precursor and amino acid around, and this will speed up the elongation rate, even if at the very start of the shift, the tRNA pool is not has not changed yet.
So why are they speeding up? How do the ribosomes know they have to go faster?
Because the tRNA pool in general is not changing, but when I have more amino acid, the percentage of charge tRNA is going up because I have more amino acid around. I mean,
Okay, so the amino acid concentration increase leads to a shift of the tRNA pools towards more charged tRNAs, and more charged tRNAs speed up elongation.
Exactly. And, okay. Okay, next, we wanted to make sure that this was really the reason we see oscillation and the presence of oscillation do not hinge on the, some macroscopic parameter that we are not that is not under control. So what we do is to compare two different systems, one with the transcriptional delays, which is the one that I showed you before, so where the dynamic of the regulatory function is given by the dynamic of the tRNAs, of the mRNAs. And we can see here in the first plot that we get the oscillation, and during the shift, the value of the regulatory function does not follow the steady state relation with the value of the elongation rate. the steady where the steady state relation is the dashed line, but during the shift, it doesn't follow it. And what we found is that even if we force the regulatory function to adjust immediately with the change in the elongation rate, so it adjusts immediately and it follows the steady state relation, we still get the oscillatory relaxation, even if, of course, the amount of oscillation is different. Okay. The doubling, I mean, the growth rate is shown here on the y-axis. So the doubling time, I think, it will be like maybe 20 minutes for the post shift.
So and maybe
we can see it better here. Yes, yes, because 3 hours is yes. Okay. And yeah, all the results that I shown you are also supported by analytical calculation where we treated our framework as a dynamical system. So we studied the eigenvalues, the stable fixed point, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, now, as a conclusion, I wanted to show some experimental evidence of the oscillation, which we do not collect, but we have searched in the literature if someone has seen this behavior. And in the first plot that I show you, here are two different work. And in the first one, we can see some really rapid oscillation of the regulatory function of the ribosome after an upshift. While in the second plot, we can see the adjusting dynamic of the growth rate for a bulk shift in between different carbon sources. And in the second plot, the oscillations are not so clear like in the first one, but we think that we cannot exclude the fact that maybe they are there. And lastly, I wanted to show those experiments, which are which we, I mean, our partner lab in Cambridge have performed this experiment where they shift from in a microfluidic device from a medium with glucose to a medium with glucose plus cas amino acid, and you can see that both the growth rate and the ribosomal sector as they both have an overshoot before relaxing to the final state. And in this case, our model can reproduce this trend if we adjust a little the parameter that connect the amino acid pool to the speed of the elongation rate. Unfortunately, in our lab, we cannot do experiment, and this phenomenon is not really well studied. I mean, not that I know. So we are doing what we can with the data we have. Yes.
So this is growth rate as a function of time.
Yes.
It's 4 hours, but sort of in the mother machine glucose, it's 80-minute doubling or something, and you go to half of that, 40 minutes or something like this. So I'm wondering, this is like a population average growth rate that you're looking at?
Yes, I mean, the data for the mother machine is a single cell, but what I'm showing here is the population average.
But you expect the oscillations to be only at the single cell level and not necessarily be in phase with each other, no?
Yeah, that's true, but nevertheless, we see them also at the population level.
I mean, you do give a clear impulse at this specific time for all the cells at the same time, right? So if there's some intrinsic time scale, then.
That's true. But I think that, you're giving a specific input, but at the single cell level, there are multiple factors that are important. For example, the phase of the cell cycle where the cell is at that specific moment. So, That's true that the signal should coordinate them, but there are also other mechanisms that can play a role. Okay, so to conclude, basically we have a framework that put together the the growth law theory with a more mechanistic with a mechanistic description of the PPGPP sensing and regulation, and the main theoretical result that we have is that we expect an oscillation, an oscillatory dynamic for the relaxation toward the new steady state. As a consequence of this, this result means that basically if you put in the model the whole chain between from the uptake of the amino acid to the protein synthesis, oscillation is what you will expect. And if this is not seen in the experiment, there's probably it's probably meaning that the cell is putting some other mechanism in order to avoid to have this behavior. So lastly, I want to thank my group for the support they gave me and all of you for the attention.
Thank you. Just a comment. So an overshoot in the response could have a functional role in speeding up the response time for protein changes.
Yes, yes.
So I was wondering if you compare situations with the overshoot and others without the overshoot and look at the response time of the new proteins being produced, if you can see this. And this could be a reason for this overshoot to exist.
Yeah, we did not compare that, but yeah, we know that, there are some paper by Alon's lab and also other paper that says that the oscillatory relaxation is probably the one that, it's the, that optimize the timing of the response. But no, we didn't compare the two versions of the model. Also because really if you put together the amino acid consumption and the ribosomal production, you will get oscillation. So we can compare different model, but with my version of the model has oscillation, we cannot get rid of them.
Sorry, can you just show that last plot again from the one you fit it against? This one here, it seems like the ribosomal mass fraction does a less of an overshoot. Is that something you expect, or is it just if you normalize it, is it sort of self-similar eventually? Even in your model, it seems like there's.
I think that also in the model, this example here, the ribosomal fraction is not oscillating as fast as the other, and I would say also the amplitude is a bit different because, as I say before, in order to change the protein composition, you need to produce new mass, so to dilute the inherit composition that you had before. So for sure, with the time scale and also the amplitude of these of the oscillation of the sectors is reduced respect to, for example, the one of the elongation rate. I don't know if I answered.
Sorry, does your model give any indication of that lag time, like a mechanistic understanding of that phase shift between ribosome fraction and growth rate, or could it?
We did not study that specifically, but just by looking at the equation of the model, the way we modelize the shift. Is that the nutrient quality nu basically goes with a jump, what it happens is that the derivative of the amino acid is discontinuous, and so is the one of the elongation of the elongation rate. But then, in order to arrive from this to the production of new biomass, you have first to change, to adjust the mRNA pool with the time scale tau, which is 10 minutes, around 10 minutes. And then you have to adjust the size of the sector with the, where the time scale here is lambda. So the faster the cell is growing, the quicker will be here. But still, you have two steps from the shift to the adjustment of the size of the sector. That's why, I mean, you have different time scales.
One more question. Last one for the talk.
So the last data that you show for FIR are the promoter. I mean, it's the GFP
data. Yes, it's the GFP signal.
Okay, so do you consider also the maturation time of the GFP, or do you, I mean, is that important?
Here they use fast maturing GFP. The maturation time was around 10 minutes, which, I mean, it's a time scale that exists, but you see that the oscillation is like 2 hours, so it's not really impacting that result.
Right. Let's thank the speaker again. And now we have our last talk, I think.